Good morning, everyone. I'm Christy Baines, leader of your church council, and I'm so excited about this morning. This year, we have taken a different approach in church council, and we've engaged all of our members through the last four meetings in talking about our missions, our outreach, the ministries here at the church, and how each of us can help strengthen our church family as a whole. Thank you for everyone for participating in What Breaks Your Heart. Through your participation and your feedback, we were able to strengthen and think about the ministries for this church and what led to Dale's program this morning in the state of the church. So what we're going to do, I'm going to hand it over to Dale, and he's going to give his program, and then we're going to wrap it up with your feedback. Just as we've been doing in church council, we want your feedback and your interaction, and that's how, as a whole, we'll be a better Canterbury church family and better ourselves.
Absolutely.
Together. So thank you.
Thank you, Christy. I want to start with a scripture reading from the book of Ephesians chapter 3, verses 20 and 21. Now to him who by the power at work within us is able to accomplish abundantly far more than all we can ask or imagine, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations forever and ever. Amen. Let's pray. Almighty and gracious God, we give thanks to you for this gathering today. We give thanks to you for the presence of your Holy Spirit, not only in this moment, but in so many moments leading up to this time in which we're able to share together and think about your church here at Canterbury. I pray that your Holy Spirit would continue to weave through this room and weave through our hearts and our minds and allow this to be your time, not my time or even Canterbury's time, but for this to be your time in which you speak your love and your grace into what we're trying to do here. Build us up with that same love and grace to be your people who are called to serve you in this world. We pray this in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, good morning. I'm so glad to see you here this morning, and I'm excited to share with you this morning. I want to tell you up front, if you're expecting anything radical or earth-shattering, it's not coming. What I want to do today is I want to share with you what my journey of getting to know you has been like for the past 10 months, because it was actually about a year ago that I first found out that I was going to be the senior pastor here at Canterbury United Methodist Church. Now, you all found out on April the 10th that I was going to be your pastor. I found out you found out on April 11th. I found out on April 8th that I was going to be your pastor. The plan was for me to do something completely different than to serve in the local church. Now, when something like that happens, here's the way my thought process goes. God must be up to something. You know, the scripture talks about even when we have the best laid plans that, you know, that God has a deeper vision for how he wants us to be and to live. And so I knew that God was up to something in my life because it was truly a last-minute decision for me to come and to be the senior pastor here. But it was also obvious to me that God was up to something because almost immediately many of you began sending cards and letters expressing welcome and your greetings to me. And I still have all of these letters, so that if you and I ever get into any kind of conflict, if you wrote me a letter, I'm going to be able to pull out that letter and go, see, this is what you said about me coming here. But once I got here, I knew that God was up to something as well. The spirit and the energy in this place is amazing. The spirit and the energy of this place is filled with love and with God's grace. And so I can stand before you today and tell you that the state of Canterbury Church is strong and vital, and that although we do face some challenges, that there is no challenge that we face that this church doesn't have the capacity to be able to respond to it with God's love and God's grace at the very center of everything that we do. One thing that I've heard more than anything else is that you love your church, and your love is contagious. I hope in the time that I've been here that you've been able to see that Ann and I love being here. We love hanging out with you. We had a great crowd here together yesterday for the steeple-to-steeple race, and we won the participation trophy. And that was a teeny tiny challenge that I put before you. But you've faced so many challenges before. I think about the brown bag ministry. As I walk through Canterbury Hall on Fridays when I'm able to be here and to interact with the people that are here, it's obvious to me that God is up to something here. Almost 1,600 people, different people, were served last year by the brown bag ministry. Over 7,500 bags of groceries were distributed. God is up to something here. Avondale Samaritan Place has some great energy going on out there that I'm just so grateful for Leanne Sisson and the work that she's doing out there. We're engaging that Avondale community in some meaningful ways. God is up to something there. Carpenter's Hands. The Stop Hunger Now. You know, we could just list on and on all of the great things that we're doing here that are having a tremendous impact on the lives of folks. And I'm grateful to you, and I'm grateful to God for all of these things that are going on. It's also obvious to me that God is up to something as we look at several of the different ministries, the program ministries that we have. Our children's ministry is one of the best in the nation. And not just our church Sunday school program, but our weekday programs. These are drawing people to our church because parents know that if they bring their children into this place, that they're going to get a quality experience from loving and caring staff and volunteers. Same is true about our student ministry. One of the things that I'm impressed about our student ministry is there are so many different activities, and at first I was thinking, gosh, y'all are doing so many different things, but in reality, our youth are so busy today that we've got to provide ministry at various times just to be able to catch them once during the week in order to be able to be in ministry with them. May not be obvious to you, but several of our adult Sunday school classes are growing. The Crawford Owen class, every week they're bringing in chairs. This is one of our oldest classes here. They started out as the Young Marrieds many years ago, which, by the way, the Young Marrieds of Crawford Owen won the award at Steeple to Steeple for having the largest group, the largest team of people to register. That's commitment, that's energy, that's vibrancy. Several of our other adult Sunday school classes are growing. I'm extremely excited about the Encore ministry. This is a ministry for families that are experiencing the challenges of life with dementia. Within a couple of weeks, we're going to be ministering to 6 individuals and their families through the Encore program. The amount of what it has taken to accomplish that is huge. But what's beautiful about that is this has really only taken about 6 months to get off the ground. This church has the capacity to respond in such powerful ways. And I think that's evidence that God is up to something here. Now, as I said, we do have challenges. Let me say this about the challenges, though. Our challenges tend not to be very different or any different than the challenges that every church is facing in the world today. We all hear the stories of these churches that are blowing and going and attracting tens of thousands of people, and that's the exception. Most churches, particularly churches that I would include in the category of Canterbury, have these same challenges of how do we be in ministry in the 21st century? How do we continue to reach out and to connect with people who lead very busy lives and who have so many demands upon their time? But I think we've got the capacity to be able to respond to those challenges. And I'm not worried about the future of this church. I have no anxiety about where God is going to take us as we try to adapt to the changing culture in which we live. Now, as I said, we do have challenges, and as I've spent the last 10 months listening to you, there are a few things that have come up as concerns. One, probably the number one concern that has been raised is the instability or the perceived instability that's been created by the staff turnover that we've had. I promise you, it's not me. Now that sounds defensive, but you know, I would even say that it's quite possible that even with this turmoil of losing so many staff over the past year and even a little beyond, I think God is up to something. I think about when a lot of those staff joined this church, joined the church staff at the various times that they joined, and the gifts and the strengths that they brought to bear upon the life and the ministry of this church, and what a positive impact that was. And when I look at the staff that we've been able to attract and to bring to Canterbury, we've got one of the best staffs, certainly in the North Alabama Conference. And I've been exposed to a lot of those staffs because that was a lot of the work that I've done for the previous 12 years, was interact with churches. And we have one of the best staffs that any church could have. And the folks that we're adding to the staff, they're bringing such energy and freshness of ideas that it's obvious to me that even with all of the transitions, that God is up to something here at Canterbury. And because a lot of the staff are younger, then what that means is that if we continue to provide a great working environment for them, and if we continue to challenge them to grow in their responsibilities and in their ministries, then 20 years from now, or 25 years from now, or 30 years from now, there's going to be another senior minister here who's having to answer all the questions of, why is all the staff leaving? But they will have done some amazing things in the life of this congregation to help us move forward into the future that God has for us. And indeed, God does have a future for us. Another concern that some folks have shared is a concern that and I'm just going to name it because I've heard it enough that I feel like I need to, that one person on staff has too much power. And I don't think they're referring to me when they say that. But what I know is that every decision that we make, certainly every major decision that we make here at Canterbury, is done through the counsel and advice of some of the most magnificent lay leadership that any church could have. Now, leadership doesn't always make popular decisions. And particularly when it comes to personnel decisions, nobody generally has all the facts. There's only a few folks who really understand everything that's going on. And when these major decisions come up, they're not made lightly, and they're not made flippantly. And there is a lot of thought, and there is a lot of prayer that goes into making all of the decisions, the major decisions that we have to make. And so I want to assure you that whether you agree with the decision that's made or whether you disagree with the decision that's made, that it's been prayed over, that it's been talked about, that it's been processed. And so I want to encourage you, rather than to jump to conclusions about motivations about why certain things happen around here, I want you just to sit back and allow yourself to remember what I've just said. And that's that everybody here wants what's best for Canterbury. And I assume that about you, and I hope that you'll assume that about everybody in leadership. It's interesting to me that in the absence of solid information here at Canterbury, that I'm just going to put it out there. Sometimes y'all like to make up answers to why things are happening, and they're not even close. And that's not helpful. If you have a question about anything that's going on around here, then ask, and we'll tell you everything that we can. Don't talk about it and stir things up, but let's talk about it. I'll just give you an example. Some folks have given me feedback on my presentation style. Folks say, you know, Dale, sometimes you're just pretty dry. You know, somebody else said, would you smile? Rob Hubbard, when he shoots a video of me that some of y'all have seen, he'll just look at me and he'll go, would you smile? But I'm an intense, serious kind of guy. But with that feedback, now, please hear me. I'm not asking you to come up and tell me, oh, we love your preaching, or oh, we love your presence. That's not what it's about. My point here is this. How am I going to get better if people don't give me honest feedback? And we've got to have that kind of atmosphere around here where we're sharing with one another to help each other to grow. Because in order for me to lead this church where God wants this church to go, I'm going to have to be a better leader. I'm going to have to be a better preacher. I'm going to have to be a better at everything that I do. And the only way that I'm going to get better is if you love me enough to talk to me about who I am and how I come across, and that's okay. Because you know what? I'm going to have those conversations with you as well. It's not a one-way street, but we're going to challenge one another to grow. We're going to challenge one another to really become the best version of ourselves. Because the work that we do in this church demands our very best. And I would even go so far as to say that the work that we do in the world demands our very best. I think that God is up to something here at Canterbury. I know God's up to something in my life, and I'm excited about what God is doing here. Some of the other concerns that I've heard raised are that that some of our young people, when they go off to college, that they're not coming back to Canterbury when they graduate. I think a lot of that happens to be related to a changing demographic around job market, but it concerns me nonetheless, because that's one of the things I've observed, is that we have a huge gap from college to young adult, and finding a way to address that, I think, is one of the challenges that we have to address. I believe that transitions are important. And what I mean by this is that when someone leaves our student ministry to go to college or to go to technical school or to go do an internship or to go into work, that we've got to be intentional about managing, helping them navigate that transition from being in high school to whatever it is they move to next. And I also believe then that we've got to maintain contact with those folks so that as they begin to make the transition to the next age and stage of their life, that not only will we be there to help them in that age and stage, but we're going to be there to help them grow through that transition to that next age and stage. When I first came here, and actually I was aware of this long before, but in 2011 there was a next step process that this was the long-range plan, and it was next step following God's way to 2020. And there were five key strategic priorities that were developed. Children and students was the first one. Meaningful worship was the second. Radical hospitality was the third. Relational outreach was the fourth. And the fifth was whole family spiritual growth. Well, what I've done, along with the staff and several of the folks who were originally on this team, is we've done some analysis of how we're doing in each of those five areas, and we're doing pretty well. I mean, we've accomplished some things in each of those areas, but that whole family spiritual growth stood out to me, because for all of my ministry, I felt like that the church has got to do a better job of the way I often refer to it as a cradle-to-grave discipleship process. One of the areas where I think that as a staff that we're going to be focusing a lot of energy is not what we previously termed whole family spiritual growth, but I want to refer to it as whole life spiritual growth, because we need to help people grow from every age and stage of their lives in an ever-deepening relationship with God. I've always said that the day I die, I hope I have grown and learned something. And what I hope I learn on the day I die is not that I'm going to hell, okay? But every day is an opportunity for us to grow, because there is no way that we will ever exhaust the depth of the relationship that we can have with God. There's always the potential to grow deeper in that relationship. And what I want to do is, I want us to look at caring for young families during the prenatal stages of childbirth, to be with families, helping them to adjust to that huge transition in their life. But then also on the other end of that is, as people are growing older and as people face death, I want us to be there with meaningful engagement in their lives, helping them to grow through that, and then every age and stage in between. How many of us have heard of the midlife crisis? How many of us have been through a midlife crisis? That can be one of the most destructive times in a family's life, when somebody in the family is going through a midlife crisis. What if, as a church, we said that we wanted to help people grow through that transition, and rather than make destructive choices, that proactively we've been a part of the previous stage of their life, that we've given them the tools needed in order to navigate that with less negative consequences? Think how that would strengthen our families, not only in that period, but beyond. This is what I mean by whole life spirituality. I think another component of this is caring for one another in more effective ways. Sam Williamson does an amazing job with our pastoral care effort, particularly hospital visitation. He knows every situation where there's someone in the congregation who is facing a terminal illness. He is Johnny on the spot to provide whatever care is needed around illnesses. My concern is that there are other life crises that we experience where I don't know that we've done as an effective job as we could. And I would say that when people are going through a divorce, when people are experiencing financial difficulty, when people are experiencing legal trouble, criminal problems, addiction, I would like to see us as a congregation be able to respond more effectively in those situations where people have a tendency to feel shame, and for us to de-shame what are common experiences every single one of us in here, either ourselves or someone in our family has experienced any of those crises that I've talked about. And we need to be a place that understands that those things happen, and rather than respond with judgment, that we respond with love and grace. So we're going to be developing some systems of greater congregational care, not just where, you know, we're hiring staff to do that, but where we're helping us as a congregation to care for one another during those difficult and troubling times that each of us experiences at some point in our lives. Another concern that people have raised is that they feel like we're losing people to other churches. Our membership is growing. Our worship attendance has been in decline from 2011, but I'm happy to say in 2015 that we have actually shown a slight increase. I don't know that that's a trend or whether that's an anomaly. But here's something I want you to know about my leadership, and that's this. Every church that I have been a part of has grown. Now, this is also important. It didn't grow because we were trying to grow the church. Every church where I've served grew because we were trying to grow people. And again, that ties back to the whole life spirituality. I think that if we're paying attention to helping you to grow in that ever-deepening relationship with Jesus Christ, that we're not going to have to worry about whether we're growing or not. That's going to take care of itself. Because if we're meeting people's spiritual needs and helping them to develop so then that they can go back out into the world and serve as followers of Jesus Christ in the world, then that's going to be contagious too. Not only the love that you have for this church that is contagious, but the love that you carry back out into the world is going to be contagious as well. I believe that God is up to something here at Canterbury in that regard. There are other challenges that we face. Our giving has been down for the past 3 years. We've had to cut the budget. I think that we need to pay some attention to that. I think that there's work to do there. But as with the growth of the church, what I would say is that if we'll focus on helping each and every one of us grow in our relationship with God, that the finances aren't going to be an issue either. Because, again, as we grow people, then we grow in our ability to respond as God leads us in whatever area of our lives. So these are kind of the bulk of the concerns that have been raised. And I want to share with you just a few more things before we move to questions. So what do I think we need to be doing? Here are just a few things. I think we need to focus our ministries. Time is the new money, particularly in a culture like ours. We don't have enough time, and we can't do everything, and so we need to maximize our time. We need to maximize our effort, and I think that we can spend some time, and certainly the council, the church council, is going to help us do this in focusing our efforts for the greatest impact. But I also think we need to open ourselves to experimentation. Again, this church has incredible resources to try some things that other churches won't be able to do. And so I would like to see us prototype and try some new things that we're not going to take a huge risk on these things, but try some new things and just kind of see how it plays out, and if then we need to scale it up and then we'll be able to share what we've learned with others. There's an issue that we've identified that's called portability. It was somewhat of a shock to me last summer at what happens to worship attendance during the summer versus worship attendance in the fall. I'd heard about it, but there's no way anybody can describe the mass exodus that occurs. But you know what? I know that this church means a lot to you, and I think we need to find ways to connect with you when you're not here. A lot of you travel. Some of you travel internationally. I would like for us to have a way that if you're in Singapore or, if you're in Beijing or if you're in Saudi Arabia, that you would have a way of staying connected to your church so that even while you were away, you knew not only that your church cared for you, but you were able to participate in the things that help you to grow. And I have no idea what portability looks like. But again, if we go back to the experimentation, I think we can lead the way in helping other churches deal with this very challenge. Another thing is what I want to call systems thinking. And we do a great job in direct aid. I was bragging about the brown bag ministry. You know, what's beautiful about that is not only the number of people that we serve, but the number of people in this church who serve. It's phenomenal to me. We had over 2,000 volunteers for the Stop Hunger Now event. I mean, this is remarkable. And we need to continue to do these things. But at some point, we need to ask the question, why are there so many people who need food? Why are there so many people who are stuck in a cycle of poverty? We have the capacity as a congregation to look at systems and to see the systems that are at work that are continuing to trap people. And then we can respond to those needs, that we need to be systems thinkers, particularly those of you who heard me talk about the VUCA world, the world of increasing volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity. In that kind of world, we need to be able to see systems and respond to those systems. I think we're going to have to work on our commitment. I've shared with you about what's happened with our budget. I hope we don't have to do that anymore. And it's going to take commitment on each of our parts. It's going to take sacrifice on each of our parts to get there. How many of you know that we have a Canterbury Foundation? Great. I would like to see us continue to work at increasing our foundation, because those assets are utilized to help both short-term and long-term with the needs of this congregation. Along the lines of commitment, I would also say we can't merely be a church of convenience either. So many of you sacrifice so much to be a part of this church. As we help people grow in their relationship with God, then sacrifice becomes irrelevant, because you don't ever feel like you're sacrificing when you get so much out of the experience that you have here. The last area that I think we need to spend some time working on is what I want to call leadership. We have a high preponderance of community, corporate, and educational leaders in this congregation. You all are the premier authorities in your field of operation. You don't play small with your career. You don't play small with your life. You play large. And I think that as a church, that we also need to quit playing small with our church and start playing large, because we're large people. We're people of higher intelligence, of higher wealth, of higher influence than so many other churches. And I believe that that is a resource that God has given us to be used for the good of the kingdom of God. So I'm not just talking about leadership in the church. We have great leadership in the church. But I'm talking about we need to focus on being a leader in the community and in the world. So where do we go from here? I'm winding up. Where do we go from here? I believe that if we work on this whole life spirituality, that if we focus on helping folks to continue to grow in that ever-deepening relationship with Jesus Christ, then we'll be better equipped to serve in the world as Matthew 25 demands that we do. So that's going to be my primary focus over the next couple of years, is developing this system of whole life spirituality. But beyond that, I think that we've got some work to do as a congregation in determining what Peter Diamandis calls a massively transformative purpose. That given the capacity that we have as a congregation, we can change the world. We can change the world. And so, over the next year to 2 years, I'm going to be asking the church council to help us to develop a process that will facilitate finding that massively transformative purpose that will not only change our church, but will change this community and even the world around us, because we can. So, what I want you to take away from this is this. God is up to something at Canterbury. Keep your eyes peeled to see just what God has in store for us. Because as the scripture says, "Now to him who by the power at work within us is able to accomplish abundantly far more than all we can ask or imagine, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations, forever and ever. Amen." Thank you for your attention. At this time, I'm going to invite Christy to come back, and she's going to facilitate our question and answer time.
All right, we'll go ahead and open it up to everyone. Do we have any questions? Feedback? Anything? Oh, here we go. Thank you, Stephen.
Do we have a master goal for security for the congregation and the church?
Can you maybe flesh that out a little bit more?
With all the terrorism that's happening, things happening in other churches around the world, do we have a master plan for security?
In fact, we do, and Jim Lott is constantly monitoring that, along with Warren Nash, and we have a critical response system that's in place. We're not going to tell you what it is, because part of its effectiveness is, it operates at all times, but you're not going to see it operational. But we take very seriously the security of this place, particularly when there are people in this place. Does that answer your question? Okay.
Thank you.
I think you touched on this a little bit earlier, but do we have a Sunday school program and a ministry specifically for college students?
No. And that's, like I say, that's an area, a glaring weakness that we have. And part of it is that college-age ministry is one of the most difficult ministries to engage in, because you've got to have something in place every time that a college student could potentially visit or be home. So you've got to have something in place, but there will be a lot of weeks where you've got something in place and nobody shows up. And so that's very discouraging for leaders in ministry, but I think there are ways that we can address that and provide that continuity so that when somebody shows up, we're there for them.
Kim?
Well, and exactly, and we, that's in the plans, is to be sure that we provide something on a regular basis, like I said, so that when somebody visits from the college, but also outreach to the colleges.
Andy Sink has a question.
So I have a question on the experimental ideas that you mentioned. Are there any experimental ideas on changing the format of adult Sunday school?
Wow. Why don't you ask a loaded question? I'm a big believer in prototyping, and so whatever ideas you have, I'm open to let's prototype it. Let's try it on a small scale and see what we can learn from it, and then see if we can then, with success, take it further and further beyond. I suspect those of you in Sunday school classes who love your Sunday school class, I'm not planning to disrupt your Sunday school class. So I want that piece of information to be out there so we don't create some alternative narrative there. But I do think that small group ministry is highly effective, particularly on Sunday morning during the Sunday school hour. Every available Sunday school classroom is being used. We don't have room to add another Sunday school class unless we do some experimentation with alternative venue, alternative type of small group experience. There's nothing currently that we're looking at, but if you've got some ideas, we'd love to hear them, because we will be looking at those. Somebody got
a question? In the back.
Add another floor. I'm breaking out in a sweat. Fill up the chairs in the current class. And that's true. Some of our classes have room to grow, and occasionally we're having to move people around to adjust to the size, the room size to the size of the class. I have to tell you, I am very impressed with the cooperation that I've already seen exhibited by the classrooms that have been asked to move or have been asked to share space. I am blessed beyond measure at the response that people here in Sunday school have demonstrated in the face of having to change space. That doesn't happen everywhere. Y'all are special.
We do have suggestions for the change of the Sunday school classes in reference to that gentleman. Where do we take those suggestions?
You can always email me, or at this point, Brian Ward would be a great person to get in touch with. Brian is doing a great job thinking about our Sunday school format and gathering ideas. And like I say, we don't have anything on the drawing board just yet, but Brian would be probably the great place to go.
What is the status on the master plan for, we were talking about growth and youth and college, for a rec center?
Evidently, I've not been here long enough to be a part of any of those conversations. Where's Jeff Stone? Jeff had a dream the other night that we started on it. So, and I'm talking about dreams and visions in my message this morning, and so I don't know whether that's what I would refer to as a catalytic event or not, That is definitely something we need to look at and see where we are, particularly as we continue to develop this whole life spirituality.
So, Dale, who on staff is focused on young adult? I remember back in 2011 when Drew came on, maybe a little earlier, there was a big push for young adult, and that has seemed to dwindle. And I think a lot of people in my Sunday school class are probably still here as a result of that movement back then, but we haven't seen any growth in that area.
Well, and I appreciate that, and I'm sorry, that the energy behind that has not been sustained. And so because we're having these staff changes, And Tori Hastings, our new associate pastor who's coming on. Y'all are going to love Tori. She is extremely intelligent, understands church systems, and she's really going to help us in a lot of areas. She'll be doing preaching primarily in the New Tradition Service. But we're trying to decide just how best to allocate the staff. I want somebody who is designated as young adult. Right now, Brian Ward is doing adult ministries, and he has a passion for young adult. But as we process around this whole life spirituality, I want us to have a staff person identified in children's as we do, in student ministry as we do, in young adult ministry as we currently don't. What I would call middle adult, which, by the way, the sociologists tell us that young adulthood is now at a minimum from 18 to 35. And some demographers actually say young adulthood extends to 45 because of the delayed in life decisions that people make. So, those of you who thought you were approaching midlife, you're still young. But have somebody assigned to middle adulthood, and then we've got Valerie Boyd who's doing senior adult. So I anticipate that once Tori gets on board and very shortly, definitely by fall, we'll have a clear path of who's responsible for what and actually even full steam ahead moving forward in all those areas. All right, he said Brian's doing an excellent job, so, all right, thank you.
Dale, hearing how the congregation could help you with the level of, with the percentage of families that give in this congregation, I think back about many years ago when we had our capital campaign, and there was a tremendous involvement by the congregation to help the staff. And for those of us that do commit each year, I think we would all be very interested in how we could help the staff and you to increase the percentages of our families giving.
Thank you for that. We shared in the church council, and you were there, I know, some of the breakdown of giving by age groups. And some of the younger members of the church council really latched onto that, and they've started dialogue in their classes. And there have been some ideas that have been generated as a result of that already, where as we move into the stewardship campaign in the fall, I think y'all are going to see some changes in how we go about it. Please understand, my goal for the first year was for me to go through and see how y'all do stuff, because whenever somebody new comes into my life and they immediately want to start changing everything about me and how I do things, you know, I'm a little uncomfortable with that. I know I've probably changed more out of ignorance than I realize, but I've tried not to change much of anything. I've really been here to study and to figure out what's going on. And I felt like our stewardship campaign had a lot of holes in it. And I think that we've got to become more relational. And so we're already working on the fall stewardship campaign. And we'll be inviting Sunday school classes to be a part of that. I think that Sunday school classes are a critical piece because that's your discipleship group. And where we can offer some more support and encouragement in that venue, so there'll be more opportunity. We're gathering folks to help us think about stewardship. So if that's an area of particular interest to you, shoot Warren Nash an email and let him know you're interested in being a part of that, because it's important, but we've got to do the best job possible that we can, and involving all of you in that at at even a development level of what it is that we do, I think is a critical piece. So thank you.
I know that everyone in here has somebody that they know that with special needs. If it's mental, physical, behavioral, how is that going to play into the whole life, whole family, where we can minister to those families when they find out they're pregnant and that child has special needs all the way through adulthood?
Oh, thank you for asking that, because I meant to say something about that. Special needs is an area where we've got some movement in that area, but we've got such a huge gap of what could be done to minister to families. And I love that you mentioned, even prenatally, to be with families when I think that if we're in relationship with families when they first find out they're pregnant, that most pregnancies have positive outcomes, but not all pregnancies have positive outcomes. And if we're already in relationship with that family, then we're able to be in ministry to them in some really significant ways as they adjust and appropriate to the news that often is not good, that rocks their world. But even beyond, some of you know, I have a brother who has done some research. He was the fire inspector for Mountain Brook, and he's done research in fire alarms and autism. And so through his research and his work, I have a keen interest in ministering to children with autism and other conditions that make it hard for them to be in public. If you have a child that there's difficulty with that child being in public, which I had a child who was prone to these outbursts, you know, had some horribly embarrassing moments on a tennis court and had to sit there while people said all kinds of things about my son who had just reached his limit, you know. But the shame that I felt because people didn't understand, we've got to create not only ministries for families who are dealing with special needs at all ages, not just children, but all ages, but as a congregation, we've also got to be educated about how to interact with people with special needs, because that would be a key piece of what I would consider radical hospitality, is welcoming those. And there's a group of folks, and you happen to be a part of that group, who is looking at ways that we can more effectively be in ministry there. And that is a huge part of whole life spirituality. Again, because it's every age and stage of life. It's every experience of life that we want to have a system in place to be in ministry at that time.
Dale, let's take one more question.
All right. Better be a good one. No pressure.
Is there an awareness on the part of church council and church staff of the untapped resources within this congregation, that there is a place for individuals to grow in response to God's gifts by being created in God's image in this place we call Canterbury?
Wow. You know, that's one of the biggest challenges that we face, is because this is a congregation where there are people who have vast gifts and abilities. Again, we're a church of large people who have a largeness about them in spirit, in leadership, in influence. And one of the biggest challenges is finding a way to tap into all of that. One piece that we do have is the Strengths Finder, but that's a small piece. You know, but we've got to find a way to to gather information about people's capabilities and capacity. And so if you have ideas about ways that we can tap into that better, I sure would love to hear it, because that is a constant challenge, a constant challenge. I want to thank you all for being here. I know that there was a lot of anxiety on some people's parts about what in the world is he going to say, and hopefully I haven't. Hopefully, what I've shared with you resonates with you. I believe that God is up to something at Canterbury, and I believe that together, as we move forward, that if we're helping each other to grow in that ever deepening relationship with Jesus Christ, that that whatever challenges we face, we're just going to charge ahead, and God is going to be with us, and it's going to be a great experience for us all. Thank you, and may I offer a prayer. Almighty God, we give thanks to you for your love for us and for the expression of that love in a place called Canterbury. Empower us as we think about our role in this church to offer ourselves to you and to your church in ways that will help us to strengthen not only this church, but to strengthen your kingdom among us. Go with us now and keep us in your care, and bring us together again as we joyfully worship you. We pray this in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.